Thank you very much, Professor Göran Sjöström. It's very nice to listen to you. And most welcome to all of you. First, let me say that we are very happy to have so many here, and we're sorry that we can't have all of you inside, but we have by Jan asking us to make some arrangement. We did so. So there's a loudspeaker outside and the White House, the President's White House, it's a loudspeaker, so I hope you can hear. And tomorrow you can go on the website of Lund University, and there you can listen and even see the picture and video from this event and listen to Jan that way. So now I, Per Eriksson, the Vice Chancellor, President of Lund University, I will start and say, Your Excellency, students, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure for me to welcome you to this Anna Lindh lecture. We are really honored that Jan Eliasson, Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations and one of Sweden's most experienced and respected diplomats, has accepted our invitation to give a lecture. The Lund University aims to be a world-class university with the mission to understand, explain, and improve our world and human condition. Human rights is therefore really important within Lund University, and I am proud of the research and education of both undergraduate and graduate level, which is taking place at many parts of the university. The Raoul Wallenberg Institute of Human Rights and Humanitarian Law is a key player within the university with its long-standing reputation in Sweden and abroad. Both Raoul Wallenberg and Anna Lindh are role models who have demonstrated that one person can make a difference, thus inspiring young people and all of us to continue their work. Their dedicated work have contributed to a better world and served as an inspiration to a younger generation. Lund University is also pleased with the cooperation with one important and active student association, the Association of Foreign Affairs and the Anna Lindh Memorial Foundation. And as you heard, the event here is framed by music played by Professor Göran Sjöström. Today, I myself arrived from a university trip to Jordan. We have, since a long time, very good relations to Jordan universities. We also, during that trip, had the opportunity to visit a new refugee camp for 120,000 refugees close to the Syrian border. That is a city bigger than Lund. And half of the number of refugees in this camp, they are children. In Jordan, more than 20% of the population are immigrants from Iraq, from Palestine, and now more and more are coming from Syria. This needs all our support. And we are now planning a Syria conference later this fall, where the initiatives come from Lund University's Center for Middle East Studies. We also have concrete problems to solve. We have students from these regions. So for instance, we have 16 Syrian students in one of the European Erasmus programs that we coordinate from Lund University that are not able to come to European universities. And if there are any one of you that could help us, we would be very happy. Their travel document, since the war coming, has experienced the limit for the time. So and we try our very best now to find ways, and if you can give us some advice, we will be really happy. So there's a lot of people that are hurt of the situation in Syria. But I think also it's promising that you see a lot of people, and I saw UNHCR working very hard in this refugee camp. So I think we are many that would like to help and now listen to lectures, what can be done and how to understand the conflict for the future. So please, most all of you, you're heartily welcome, especially Jan Eliasson. And now I will give the floor to Lena Hjelm-Wallén, former Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs, member of the Board of Trustees, Raoul Wallenberg Institute, please.
Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it's a great pleasure and honor to me to introduce Jan Eliasson, even if I know that not much of specific introduction is needed. Jan is well known, and many can witness about being inspired by your commitment, Jan. And so many who has listened to you have been able to add new knowledge and a new perspective to their international knowledge. Jan Eliasson has spent a long and successful life in the field of diplomacy and international politics. I will not present all the details in his CV, then I will take the whole evening, and because it is a long CV. In short, Jan Eliasson has served as ambassador, as a state secretary, as a foreign minister of Sweden. That is the Swedish part of it, and that goes, of course, together with a lot of international activities, as you heard. The other part, the big bulk of it, is UN affiliated. And Jan Eliasson was president of the 60th session of the UN General Assembly, and he has worked for United Nations in many positions and been entrusted to mediate in many hotspots and conflicts. For example, Darfur in Sudan, Somalia, Nagorno-Karabakh, Iran, Iraq. And with this broad experience from mediation, he is always keen to give his experience and knowledge to young diplomats and to students interested in international matters. Thereby, he is also visiting professor to Uppsala University and Gothenburg's University. Today, we welcome Jan Eliasson as Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations. And we are especially grateful that you have fulfilled your program in Sweden this time. This morning, we were even a bit worried. I mean, it was a competition about the airspace over Arlanda, you can imagine. But you managed. And it is also so that you are asked for in New York. Just when we were about to go into this lecture room, it was a phone call from New York. And that's your life just now. But I know that an Anna Lindh lecture is something very special for Jan. It has a great importance. Anna Lindh as Minister of Foreign Affairs and Jan Eliasson as her State Secretary worked together and was a very successful team in the foreign ministry in the late 90s. Anna has now been dead for 10 years, and she is still remembered as a brilliant Minister of Foreign Affairs, always with a sharp eye on human rights and always prepared to speak up about human rights abuses. Anna was a vigorous and optimistic person, and she and Jan stimulated each other in that spirit, and to see to that it is a duty to use all possibilities to make the world a better place with less oppression, less poverty. And the rule of law and respect for human rights were cornerstones in her foreign policy. First and foremost, violent conflicts and war should be prevented. So a priority must be conflict prevention. And that is also the theme that Jan has chosen for this lecture today, United Nations Prevention and Peaceful Settlements of Disputes. Of course, today we focus very much on Syria and the devastating situation for the people in Syria, as well as the Syrian refugees in neighboring countries, and also the dangerous risks for an even wider conflict in the region. It is appalling that the Security Council ran away from its responsibility to shoulder political leadership in this situation, and thereby the Security Council prevent the UN from playing the role we have expected from the United Nations. Such a situation could easily lead to frustration for many of us. Thanks heaven, never with Jan. He always tried to look at options, openings, new perspectives to overcome locked situations. This belief, making the impossible possible, is something that has characterized Jan. It is a pleasure to work together with Jan, which I did at a daily basis during my 4 years as Minister of Foreign Affairs, as well as before that and after that. Jan's genuine commitment is inspiring, and it has grown from deep knowledge, well-known capability, and broad experience. That's why I think so many today have looked forward to listen to the Anna Lindh lecture by Jan. Before you get the floor, Jan, a small story regarding all your titles. I want to reveal some words from your mother. When you told her that you have been asked to be cabinet secretary, secretary of state, with a certain distance to the diplomatic life, she said, and it's better in English than in Swedish, I take it in Swedish first. Well, that's okay, det verkar väl trevligt, men nu har du varit departementssekreterare, undergeneralsekreterare, och nu ska du vara statssekreterare eller kabinettssekreterare. När ska du sluta vara sekreterare? The word secretary is a bit complicated in international matters because it is has a higher profile in international wordings, but she was not very impressed. I think she was impressed by your work anyhow. After the speech of Jan, there will be a question time, and that will be conducted by Rolf Ring from the Raoul Wallenberg Institute. So he is the one to give you the floor. So, Jan, we welcome you as Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations. Please, Jan Eliasson.
Vice Chancellor Ericsson, Chairman Sven Setter, Director Tuma, honored guests, honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, dear students, dear friends. I'm very glad to be introduced by my friend Lena Hjelm-Wallén. We have championed together. You were actually the one who recruited me as State Secretary, and our friendship is there forever, and I really thank you for your warm words, recalling my mother is not being too impressed by my career. You need to be brought down to earth by your family. It's very useful. I am, of course, extremely grateful to be invited to deliver this lecture in honor of Anna Lindh and also Raoul Wallenberg. And I'm, of course, extremely happy to be in Lund and at Lund University, which I visited so many times from the time I was a student in Göteborg, where we went to the best celebrations in Sweden, I remember, here in this town. Some of it is forgotten. Someone said that the little I remember I shall never forget. But it wasn't that bad. But it's great to be here, and I also think it's good that so many wanted to come here, and I'm glad, Per, that you arranged for the loudspeakers outside, and you also told about the modern technology to spread the word. Thank you so much for that, and that you came in spite of the fact that there is full coverage hour by hour of President Obama's visit to Stockholm. So thank you very much for coming. Let me first of all start by expressing my thanks to Raoul Wallenberg Institute of Human Rights and Humanitarian Law. It is indeed a privilege for me to deliver this lecture in honor of Anna Lindh, who, as we all know, and as also Lena recalled, died far too young and far too early, 10 years ago, almost to the day, next week. A great loss to Sweden and to the world. The Raoul Wallenberg Institute's mission, and I quote, to promote universal respect for human rights and humanitarian law, was clearly reflected in Anna's life and career. Her commitment to the United Nations, her attention to conflict prevention, and her defense of human rights continues to serve as an inspiration for all of us. I want to do something which was not in my manuscript, because I received the text of this message last night. During the last week, I've been working almost day and night on the Syria crisis, and I've been in frequent contact, among others, with Samantha Power. Samantha Power is the present U.S. ambassador to the United Nations and also the author of a fantastic book on genocide, which I really recommend you to read. She was also, between 2006 and 8 or 9, the first Anna Lindh Professor of Practice of Global Leadership at Harvard University in the United States, which says a lot about Anna Lindh's international stature. When I mentioned to Samantha Power that I was going to Sweden last Thursday or Friday, she stopped talking about Syria. And she started to talk about Anna. And then before she hung up, she said, Jan, I will send you a message that I want you to convey to my friends in Sweden. So today I read out what she wrote to me last night. Today, as I walk the same corridors at the United Nations as Anna, I am moved by what is so rare today, Anna's ability to find commonality and friendship with her colleagues, even those across political lines, without compromising her views or changing her plain-spoken diplomatic style. On a personal level, as a mother of two young children myself, Anna's profound dedication to her family is something I can only hope to emulate. It is astounding to consider that 10 years has passed since the world lost Anna. But thanks to all of you, her legacy lives as new generations of diplomats and advocates continue to be inspired by her life through occasions like this one. Anna was irreplaceable, but in her honor, we will all continue to try to end oppression, eliminate extreme poverty, expand global partnerships, and embody the kind of future that she dreamed we could have. So that's from Samantha Power, as indication of her international, Anna's international standing. But today I would also like to pay tribute to Raoul Wallenberg, one of the world's great humanitarians and champions of human rights. Last week, on August 27, we celebrated the first annual Raoul Wallenberg Day in Sweden, as you all know. It is a tragedy that Raoul never got the chance to see the creation of the United Nations and to follow how the organization came to represent the values she stood for. His life and his name, like Anna's, we will never forget. I dare say, I hope, that both Anna and Raoul are with us in spirit today as examples of the difference that an individual can make for humanity, as the Vice Chancellor said earlier. They should serve as role models for young people, and not least for today's national and international civil servants. My remarks today, and I regret they are in English, for the Swedish-speaking, you have a chance to pose your questions in Swedish, though, so don't worry. I'm bilingual, don't worry. They will focus on conflict prevention and peaceful settlement disputes, one of the basic pillars of the United Nations. These were issues at the heart of Anna Lindh's public life, and to which I also have dedicated most of my professional life. I will make the case that the potential of Chapter 6 of the UN Charter, and I always carry it with me since about 1980, when I started to mediate for the UN in the Iran-Iraq War together with Olof Palme. This charter has a Chapter 6, which is entitled Pacific Settlement Disputes, Peaceful Settlement Disputes. It is this potential is tremendous, but, and I claim, it remains underutilized. In today's troubled world, it is needed more than ever. The political solutions, the diplomatic solutions, the power of the word, the power of mediation. Let me start with a bit of perspective. The world and its conflicts have changed considerably since the creation of the UN. And so has the organization. In the early years, the United Nations went through periods of conflicts between nations. Later in the 1990s in particular, there was a rapid proliferation of conflicts inside nations, often turning into horrible civil wars, which required markedly different responses. Since the end of the Cold War, the number of violent conflicts has declined significantly, I should say. This development can partly be attributed to the progress of the UN in peacemaking and peacekeeping. These tools remain necessary, of course, but today's challenges demand an expanded toolbox in which conflict prevention must have a prominent role. I can't emphasize enough the power and the importance of prevention. And to the students here, I really ask you, pursue that study as deep as you can of how you deal with the early stages of conflict or problems arising and how you deal with them at that stage rather than waiting for the tragic results later on. Have you thought about how seldom we hear about successful prevention? Just think about media and headlines that you see. I ask yourself, how often do we see headlines in the press? And I don't blame the journalist, but how often have you seen headlines saying that a disaster did not occur? Not very often, unfortunately. And there is a tendency on the part of many to focus only on fires or extinguishing fires that are underway. Our task, our imperative, must be to be there when smoke first appears, or even better, when the arsonist reaches for the match. Conflict prevention lies at the heart of the UN Charter. Its very first article states that the organization is to take effective collective measures for the prevention and removal of threats to peace. The methods for upholding this collective responsibility are elaborated in Article 33 of Chapter 6 of the Charter, which stipulates that, and I read to you, and you may count on the fingers what we should do before we employ the use of force. The parties to any dispute shall first of all seek a solution by, and this I call it's almost Christmas Eve for a diplomat or for a jurist, for a lawyer. Seek a solution should first of all, the solution should first be sought by negotiation, inquiry, mediation, conciliation, arbitration, judicial settlement, resort to regional agencies or arrangements, or other peaceful means. 8 different methods. This is poetry, as I said, for a diplomat or a lawyer, when it comes to peaceful settlements or disputes. Slowly but surely, however, we have learned to use these instruments in new ways, adapting to new circumstances. Sometimes, I admit, by trial and error. The popular notion and image of the Secretary General as the world's top diplomat rests not only on his impartiality, but also on his creative use of these methods given by the Charter. Preventive diplomacy is being conducted by more actors using more tools than ever before. There is a growing global support for prevention, coupled with new preventive capacity in international organizations and member states. And this growing engagement means that we are now more involved in multiple peace processes at different stages, from crisis management and mediation to post-conflict dialogue and reconciliation. Let me give you some examples. The first one is from my own personal experience in Southern Africa. It dates back to 1991-92, when the region suffered one of the worst droughts in its history. 11 countries were threatened by starvation and death. We knew at the UN that we had only a month or so to avoid a huge humanitarian crisis. At the time, I was UN Under Secretary General for Humanitarian Affairs, and I cooperated closely with the sub-regional organization in Southern Africa, SADC. And in spite of apartheid sanctions at the time, we used major ports in South Africa to send water drilling equipment and critical humanitarian assistance to the region. We used railroads through South Africa and set up, also against the sanctions rules at the time, a World Food Program office in Johannesburg. I remember so well talking to the permanent representative ambassador of Nigeria, who was heading the anti-apartheid committee. I was chairing the trust fund earlier, so I knew him very well. And I told him about our dilemma. We had to save lives in this whole area. And I said to him, in order for us to do that, we have to use South African ports and get the railways going and open an office in Johannesburg. And I still remember his very elegant diplomatic answer. I didn't hear what you said, because this implied breaking the sanctions. And he sort of just didn't want to be asked. The operation was successful, and very few lives were lost. But if I ask you, not many people did know about this operation, and do know still today, about an operation and this innovative diplomacy and logistics that made it possible. In other words, that headline never occurred. The disaster did not occur. Just to prove the point how difficult it is to make the case of prevention, both for diplomats, but I guess also for politicians and in other walks of life. It's an interesting study, research potential for all of you. Yemen offers another revealing case history. Yemen is practically the only country in the region to emerge from the recent upheaval in the Arab world with an agreed blueprint for a negotiated transition. The special advisor of the Secretary General facilitated face-to-face negotiations, leading to the signature in 2011 of a 2-year roadmap for peace and reconciliation. A national dialogue is now taking place. The Yemeni constituencies remain inside this political framework, this political process. And this underlines, in my view, the usefulness of multilateral diplomacy in combination with parallel national efforts. The third example is Iraq-Kuwait. This relationship shows the value of quiet diplomacy and negotiations. In recent years, the UN mission in Iraq has used its good offices for the normalization of the Iraq-Kuwait relations. And this is, of course, a remarkable turnaround from the 1991 conflict period. Credit is due, first and foremost, of course, to the Iraqis and the Kuwaitis themselves, but it is also an area in which UN diplomacy made a notable difference. In Somalia, where I have worked a lot, we have succeeded now to reach a potential turning point, I underline potential. A year ago, a new Somali parliament was elected and a president was elected, Hassan Sheikh Mohamud. I met him in London recently. The transitional period ended peacefully following an inclusive, transparent, Somali-led process. The UN spared no effort in supporting these efforts, including by facilitating logistics, helping keep spoilers in check, and there are some, and many in fact, and to establish institutions, which is so important for development and for peace. But the situation remains very fragile. Yesterday, as you may have seen, there were reports of another attack on the president. And our staff in Somalia are also working under difficult security conditions, as the June terrorist attack on our personnel made evident. Despite this, Somalia today, I would say, has the best chance in a generation to finally bring a measure of peace and normal life to its people. Actually, the worst period in my life professionally was being in Somalia in 1992. It was the closest to hell that I've ever been into. And it has certainly marked my life. So I hope to God that we will see that turnaround in Somalia. Many efforts are needed inside the country and from the outside. One final example, completely unknown to most of you and to many of even inside the United Nations. There has been a long dispute between Cameroon and Nigeria over the Bakassi Peninsula. If anyone knows anything about that, raise your hand. I would be surprised. But this is a very long sort of boiling crisis, a tense situation that could have spiraled, in fact, into a violent conflict. But it turned around when the two countries took the wise decision to settle their differences peacefully. And I have a particular passion for the rule of law as an agent of peace. And so I find it especially encouraging that this case was resolved finally through the International Court of Justice, the rule of law. When I speak of preventive tools, I want to say a few words about the growing role of regional organizations. The drafters, who were geniuses, I must say, of the UN Charter, showed great insight and foresight when in Chapter 8, they gave a crucial role to regional arrangements for peace and security. Believe it or not, I think there was only one functioning regional organization at the time, the one for Latin America. Maybe the Arab League, perhaps, was also starting to function, but there was nothing like European Union or ASEAN or anything else. But still, they wrote a special chapter in the UN about the need of regional arrangements, regional solutions. In fact, conflicts were to be solved first in the region, and then they would go to the UN. Great foresight. And I think even they would be astonished to see today's broad landscape and role of regional and sub-regional organizations, these framers of the Charter. The African Union's role in Africa is evident, and the European Union's efforts in the Balkans, a bit too late, perhaps one could say, but still now, are clear illustrations of the role of regional organizations for regional peace and indeed world peace in today's world where everything is interconnected. Regional actors are often better positioned to identify, pinpoint crises early. they have significant knowledge of and influence in their regions, of course. But still, I would say, working with regional partners is not without problems. Capacities and resources vary a lot, and sometimes regional organizations are dominated by countries which have national interests in a conflict, affecting their role as honest brokers. Different negotiation strategies can also at times pull in different directions, even clash. And we often lack a shared and accepted mechanism between the UN, regional and sub-regional organizations on how to work together when a crisis erupts. As in practically any situation, the key answers and solutions are to be found in deepened dialogue. Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has made cooperation between the UN and regional organizations a priority. He regularly convenes heads of regional organizations for consultations. Our staff are working more and more closely with regional partners. And as with prevention, we are only beginning to realize the full potential of what regional organizations can achieve. I would say that Chapter 6 and Chapter 8 are the chapters of the Charter that have the greatest potential for the UN as we now prepare for the future. Dear friends, preventing instability and armed conflict is closely linked to respect for human rights and the dignity of man. In the words of Dag Hammarskjöld, the second Secretary General, and I quote, "Without recognition of human rights, we shall never have peace, and it is only within the framework of peace that human rights can be fully developed." At the 2005 UN World Summit, when I was President of the General Assembly, as Lena reminded us, member states endorsed the interdependence between peace, development, and human rights. There is no peace without development. But there is no development without peace. And there is no lasting peace or sustainable development without the rule, without respect for human rights. And to this, I would today add another element, the rule of law. These pursuits have to be carried on at the same time. I remember as being a student, I heard a theory that first you have peace, and then you have development. And once you have peace and development, you can introduce human rights. Pretty primitive approach. Of course, you have to do all three at the same time. If one of these pillars is weak, the whole structure is weak. I saw it myself in many conflict areas, latest in Darfur. So they are interdependent. So you have to be able to know all three areas or work together with those who represent the other areas in order to really achieve results in today's world. And in any society today, because it all goes for a nation itself to have that peace, development, and human rights, and equity, and rule of law. Is it a reminder that I'm talking too long, or? six o'clock. Take a breather. Everything I've seen in my career, whether in the service of Sweden or the United Nations, tells me that the rule of law is basic for the building of a nation and a peaceful world. It is a central part of conflict prevention. It is often a recipe against the abuse of power. It binds all of us, leaders and citizens alike, to high standards of governance, both nationally and internationally, and it gives us means to challenge injustice. Through strong institutions, the rule of law is also a powerful tool for driving economic growth and social progress. I think a little bit about Sweden also, our home country. What Sweden, as you know, was one of Europe's poorest countries 80 years ago. There was a change of direction, and there were three major strategic choices in the 1930s, approximately. One was to build strong, honest institutions. And the second was to build good infrastructure for the nation. And the third one was a good solid, fair educational system, which made it possible for everybody who had the capacity to have the education he or she deserved for free. These were the three major ways in which we built a nation. And I would say having good, strong, honest institutions is perhaps one of the most important aspects of building a good society and a good world and to achieve good development. But rule of law is also important to preserve peace. After a conflict, you need to have institutions that hold the nation together. We failed, I would say, in Somalia and Afghanistan, where institutions were not built up. Then the conflict erupted again. And of course, the relationship to the members of Rav Lalman Institute is obvious, to between rule of law and human rights are absolutely obvious. Let me also recall that Raoul Wallenberg, he knew this well. I'll give you an example. He knew it instinctively, of course. He didn't talk about rule of law, but what he did, he issued identity documents to persecuted Jews. He used the rule of law ingeniously to confront evil by giving these passports, which, of course, was a bit unconventional, but he saved lives. He didn't ask questions at the time. I'm glad that the Wallenberg Institute has focused on the rule of law, including by publishing an excellent rule of law guide for politicians. And I'm also glad, by the way, that today President Obama is honoring Raoul Wallenberg just, I think, 2 hours ago in Stockholm. The 2005 World Summit endorsed another concept of importance for our topic today, and that is the responsibility to protect. This was a milestone achievement. I remember the excitement in the room among member states and civil society when what we called R2P was adopted, responsibility to protect. Preventing atrocity crimes, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, ethnic cleansing, is a central obligation of the international community. The responsibility to protect is not a new code word for humanitarian intervention, nor is it an infringement of state sovereignty. Rather, it reframes sovereignty as a positive responsibility by which governments have a duty to protect their own populations from serious crimes. When humanitarian intervention was first discussed, it was rejected. I was then Under Secretary for Humanitarian Affairs. It was rejected because it was considered interference in internal affairs. But now with the responsibility to protect, you ask the first question to the states and their governments. Don't you think you have an obligation to prevent your people from being subjected to what I just mentioned, genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, ethnic cleansing? And of course, the answer to that is yes. So you enhance the value of sovereignty, that you have an obligation to prevent your population. The problems start, of course, when you then fail to live up to these obligations, because then it is the international community that has a responsibility, and if we act wisely, which we sometimes don't do, like in Syria, then we can deal with this on the preventive level. But when it comes to the final stages, whether we should be proceeding by use of force, then we still come back to the Security Council. It is the Security Council then that decides on use of force. There are, in fact, only two ways in which legally use of force can be applied according to the Charter. One is in self-defense, Article 51. I see Anders here, a great expert from the Foreign Ministry. Great to see you. And of course, also use of force decided by the Security Council. Those are the two cases. Preventing armed conflict is distinct from, thereby, and at the same time related to the responsibility to protect. In practice, the two concepts are linked, since many atrocity crimes occur under the cover of war. Protecting vulnerable populations should compel us to take preventive action. But if we reach a point where we face a stark choice between military action, on the one hand, and passivity, on the other hand, in the face of massive suffering and massive crimes of violations of human rights, then something has gone wrong. Syria is a prime case in point. We always have to strive for political solutions, fully supported by the UN Security Council. In the same vein, prevention itself requires constant engagement and innovation. We need more and better early warning mechanisms. We need institutionalized dialogue between communities and states. We need education that fosters respect for diversity, which in itself, to me, in itself is a great degree of conflict prevention. I very much welcome the Raoul Wallenberg Institute's research and work in these areas, areas which also strongly engaged Anna Lindh. In the United Nations, we are examining what more we can do to prevent atrocities. I have led an internal process that examined the problems we faced in our response to the crisis in Sri Lanka at the end of the recent civil war, when many thousands of civilians were killed. Soon, we will present a forward-looking action agenda to improve our capacity to respond to similar tragic events. Two of the steps that we most probably will propose are one, a sharper focus on human rights violations as early warning signals. When we see the feel the first vibrations on the ground with human rights violations, we know there is conflict coming. And the second thing that we will probably suggest is greater flexibility for the United Nations presence in the field to adapt to changing conflict conditions and circumstances. Dear friends, I have painted a largely positive picture of prevention and conflict resolution, but let me in closing admit that preventing conflict is an uphill battle. With so many pieces in motion, from clashing interests to unpredictable personalities, and to the full range of human vanity and human frailty, success is elusive, or at least uncertain, I must say. Still, we have shown, and we must continue to show, that prevention can work. The UN has the charter's support through Chapter 6 and the tools, mediation, special envoys, partnerships, human rights norms, fact-finding missions, field presence, close contact with national and local actors, including civil society. There is a special track in diplomacy which we call Track 2, with Track 2 diplomacy is also involving civil society, and I found it very interesting and innovative. But let me end where I started, taking inspiration from Article 1 of the UN Charter. In the face of armed conflict or threats to the peace, it is our responsibility to act, and it is our responsibility to work collectively. And we must work preventively before disasters occur. We must maintain the momentum around diplomacy and find unified political solutions to crisis, as is now so urgently needed to end the horrendous Syrian conflict. And I would hope, in the spirit of what Lena said, that the Security Council would accept its responsibility for international peace and security in this horrific situation in which we found ourselves. This is what people everywhere impatiently and rightfully expect from the United Nations, and not least from its member states. And it is what the Secretary General and I and our colleagues at the UN are committed to doing. I count on the Raoul Wallenberg Institute and you all in this hall to join us as partners, united by a commitment to the purposes and principles of the UN, and in very closing, inspired by the examples of Raoul Wallenberg and Anna Lindh. And I thank you very much. So now I am ready for the informal part. I will leave my manuscript aside and answer absolutely spontaneously without preparations, so take advantage of this opportunity. Thank you very much. So I'm ready for questions. I think your old friend will be the maestro here.
I will try to do my best. Alejandro.
Thank you very much. Alejandro Fuentes from the Raoul Wallenberg Institute. It has been an honor and pleasure to listen to you. And I think you touched upon the question that perhaps all of us right now has, that is in connection with Syria, and the application of the doctrine of responsibility to protect. It's clear, but it seems to be clear from your...
Rolf, why don't you take three questions in a row? Go ahead.
It seems to be clear from your presentation that in order to use or to resort to the use of violence, we need the authorization of the Security Council. But according to the coalition of will states, or at least to one state, in case of self-defense of civilian population, and a state can resort to this doctrine and use the use of force as preventing other mass atrocities. Do you think that in the current development of international law, there is room for the individual use of the doctrine of responsibility to protect without a clear authorization of the Security Council? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vice General Secretary, for your speech. However, I would like to touch on the Syrian conflict. There's much said about the failure of the Security Council regarding to the conflict. Even former General Secretary Kofi Annan earlier this week expressed his disappointment in the way the Security Council has handled the conflict. And he claimed that the conflict wouldn't have escalated to this level had the Security Council done its role. However, don't you think that there's a need to separate the failures of Russia and China from the failures of the Security Council? And don't you think it's time to reform the Security Council in order for it to take its responsibilities than having these coalitions of uniting with USA, Great Britain, France, and China and Russia on the other side? Don't you think we need a reform to bring in countries that take more responsibilities of global issues than countries that are taking self-interests? Thank you.
We'll take one more question. Is there one?
The question is actually very similar to the second question that was just asked, which is you highlighted the benefits of the current institutional setup of the United Nations, but yet in the current crisis we see that the institution that was set up 60 years ago sometimes has issues in dealing with the crisis, for example, as in Syria. And so I was wondering whether these institutions, such as the Security Council, need to be reformed.
Well, I guess the two last questions can be combined, and they all relate to Syria. On the legal aspects of use of force, there are actually, in international law and in the Charter, only two ways that are accepted as legitimate for use of force. One is, as I said, Article 51, the right of self-defense. Every nation, everybody has a right of self-defense. That is clear. The second one is the decision when decisions have been taken by the Security Council. And that means that one veto can stop action in the Security Council. In the case of Libya, which has been very much debated, the two nations decided not to present the veto. They abstained, Russia and China at the time. And that made it possible for the action to take place with legal cover. In the case of Syria, that has not been the case. What has been debated the last few days is whether the use of chemical weapons could be a reason for an action also outside the United Nations. That is still up to the Security Council to decide. The outstanding issue is for the UN to first of all conclude that chemical weapons have been used. There are some nations who claim that they have the proof even of who used the chemical weapons, while others say we don't have that, and that is very evident inside the members of the Security Council. We are now awaiting the results of the inspections that were taking place the last 2 weeks, and the work in the laboratories is now going on, and we hope to have the results out very soon. That will then possibly define whether there has been the use of chemical weapons and which weapons have been used. But this group has not been mandated to conclude who used the chemical weapons, although possibly one can draw conclusions from the test, which I don't know yet. The second issue is that, of course, we understand the emotional, and rightly so, reaction to the use of chemical weapons. And in whatever perspective that you have, and I would hope that in the end the Security Council would find common ground and act on the basis of international law. But I still think, once it is established what has happened, and if that proves to be the use of chemical weapons, then of course some type of action is necessary. Because it is a crime against humanity, it is something which is written into international customary international law, and there have to be ways of reacting against this. And that can also, of course, hopefully be done through the United Nations. The problem that I hope I will not have to face, or we will not have to face, is an action completely outside the United Nations. One can perhaps understand the emotional engagement in punishment of a party that one thinks is guilty of this. But of course, if you think about the future, whether it opens up for anyone to decide that one would want to take an action of its own, or his own, or their own, in a particular case, and create an alliance to use the force, then of course you're out on a slippery road. And that is what we have to always think about. So I would hope that A, we will soon find out more about the facts, and B, that the Security Council will, in the end, accept its responsibility for international peace and security. I hope that important contacts are taking place now, in the next day or so too, in St. Petersburg, when the key actors meet and hopefully talk about this issue seriously. On your the second and third question, yes, I understand you. I usually say that the United Nations is a reflection of the world as it is, whether we like it or not. And that, but it's that also, the United Nations must also be a reflection of the world that we want to see, the world we desire, the world as it should be. And if I were to define my job, I would say my job is to try to diminish the gap between the world as it is and the world as it should be. But you have a point. The membership of the United Nations Security Council was decided in 1945. And there are nations today that eagerly, impatiently wait for a stronger role when it comes to international peace and security. And this is one of the most difficult issues to reach solutions to in the United Nations. When I was President of the General Assembly, this was the area where I certainly must admit defeat. We could not make progress. We could create the Human Rights Council, we could create the Peace Building Commission, we could have an anti-terrorism, counter-terrorist strategy and so forth, but Security Council reform was extremely difficult. For the Secretary and me, this is outside our responsibility. It is the member states that decide. There are negotiations going on, but they are making very, very slow progress. But I would say that if the Security Council continues to fail to reach decisions on crucial issues that have been brought up by you here today, there will be a rising expectation for the Security Council to reform. That's all I can say at this point. Okay, let's have another round. If you have further questions, please.
Hello, thank you so much for your inspiring speech. I, too, am representing the Raoul Wallenberg Institute, and we have a lot of programs working with national human rights institutions, mostly in Asia and Africa. And you spoke earlier about international and regional actors working for prevention and peaceful settlement of disputes. And it would also be interesting to hear your views on the work of national human rights institutions as mechanisms for prevention of internal conflicts as well as armed conflicts between states, as well as the UN collaboration with these institutions. Thank you.
So I'm also happy to announce a question from a gentleman who listened from the outside, please.
Oh, great.
Hello, Mr. Eliasson.
Thank you for entering.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
I have a question that I thought you might sort out for me, which I'm really confused about. Now, the UN is an organization which self-proclaims that it defends justice. Now, this is an idea which I find hard to digest when it only seems to defend the benefits of its five permanent members and their allies. When something is to the benefit of these five permanent members and their allies, the UN comes in and defends it. If you allow me to give an example, when the Gulf War happened, the UN didn't hesitate to go into Kuwait and defend Kuwait, which is a very strategic ally to the US. But when the Rwandan genocide happened, where 1.5 million people died, the UN did almost nothing. So that's my question.
Okay, I'll take one more if there is one.
Going back to the issue of Syria, I happen to have been in Syria when the uprising started in 2011. And one of the things that people said at that time was they were watching in amazement at Egypt, saying that what the Egyptian people are doing, we wish that we could do. But we haven't yet broken through the wall of fear, which I thought was a very powerful expression. But when I talk to my Syrian friends today, their biggest fear is no longer of the regime, but what will happen once the regime collapses. What will happen when enough people have died when the regime collapses, because they think it will. But the transitional period, the post-conflict, where you have the bad examples of Iraq and other examples in the region, are not very positive. So I'd like you to say something about the post-Assad Syria.
I'll respond to these three. For human rights to be achieved and implemented, you have to have work done on all levels. You have, of course, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the international structures that exist, Human Rights Council and so forth. But you need also to have the human rights elements introduced in regional organizations. African Union has a good chapter on human rights. European Union also stands for certain values, the Copenhagen Principles, you know, Lena and others. But you also have to have a lively human rights agenda inside nations. It has to be known. And it has to penetrate societies. And of course, that's where we often see resistance from regimes who do not want this to be seen. And here we have a great dilemma for the United Nations, because even if this charter that I often refer to has as its three first words, "We the peoples," it is an organization that is composed of nation states represented by their governments. And that's where we run into this problem constantly of being charged with interference in internal affairs. Although I claim that human rights must always be universally accepted and claimed, and that interference in internal affairs does not apply to human rights, but it is a political fact. Yes, indeed, we have sometimes that resistance. So I would think that the support to human rights defenders, to human rights groups, is very important for individual nations, and we do as much as we can through different channels, through our human rights subservices, through rapporteurs, Human Rights Council, and of course also our normal work on development, since I think, and we also should work in the spirit of peace, development, human rights being one. But it is a bit of a dilemma, but I think it's important that those people are not left alone, and that we make sure that we see them and see their situation, and see that their struggle actually deals with human dignity and our own basic values. Your example of the P5, as we call them, the permanent five, being in a favored position, of course, they have the veto, which gives them a particular role in the organization. There are those who, I think some of the charter authors have said that they felt the greatest discomfort when they wrote the charter and included the veto rights. And one of them, I think, wrote in one of his books or memoirs that He did so because he realized that if the bigger nations in the world did not take the United Nations seriously, and they wouldn't take the United Nations seriously if they didn't have that veto right, then we would have a continued weak international structure as we had during the League of Nations. That was their reasoning, and I think a reason for the involvement of the international major actors, although, as you yourself criticize them in this case. There is an important difference between Kuwait and Rwanda, and it also points to one of those dilemmas that we face in this organization. The first example, Kuwait-Iraq, is a clear example of international aggression. It is Iraq attacking Kuwait, going across the border, and by military means, conquering a nation. So it's a clear-cut case of aggression, a clear-cut case of an international threat to international peace and security. So it was relatively easy, I remember, for the Security Council to come to that decision and to create this coalition of the willing that played this important role for the ending of that conflict and for Saddam Hussein to return back to Baghdad from Kuwait. The second example is a tragic example of the difficulties of dealing with civil war situations or internal conflict. I find it almost painful physically to notice that when I know that there are serious violations of human rights, and even worse, as in the case of Rwanda, which we later saw, that solidarity has to stop at a border and not at human beings in need. For the United Nations to play that role that you ask for required a Security Council decision to play a military role when that conflict erupted. I could go as far as to say that in retrospect, a stronger presence on the ground could have been useful. This has been admitted by some of those who are involved on the political level, also in the P5, that the presence there could have had a deterring effect, possibly. I know myself from my work as humanitarian emergency coordinator in the UN that I often asked for international eyes and ears. I myself was part of that, of being in a certain conflict situation. By being there as international eyes and ears, we could have a deterring effect on the conflict. United Nations left, that could be debated. And by that, there were very few international witnesses. But it is truly the great difference between those two cases is one clear-cut aggression, international conflict, two, an internal conflict of huge proportions and a civil war with a duration of 4 months and 800,000 people killed. But it's a stain on the conscience of humanity, and this was in fact the reason we succeeded, and I was part of that negotiation, for the success of Responsibility to Protect. Srebrenica and Rwanda were the reasons why the political resistance to Responsibility to Protect was adopted, because that's when the states were forced to admit that they had a responsibility to protect their population from genocide and other atrocities. I like that word, wall of fear. I will steal it from you. I'm very, very much engaged in this issue that we live in a world now where fear has become part of the political environment. It's one of the saddest consequences of the 9/11 tragedy was that the fear factor came into our nations. We started to look in different parts of the world around. We saw each other as potential enemies, judging from religious identity or ethnic or sectarian identity. And we saw the outside world as a problem rather than a potential and a possibility. Huge problem in today's world that we see that trend being strengthened. But to bring it to the Syrian level, you are absolutely right. I was working with the Syrian conflict years ago, from my national perspective, of course, but then also when I got into this profession and this job as Deputy Secretary General, I would say one thing. It has become worse and more difficult to solve by every month. Because you have seen the now sacrifices being 100,000 dead and all the figures that you heard earlier about the people, the refugees. And then, of course, the revenge factor becomes so much stronger. And groups that were almost unknown 2 years ago and not very important players 1 year ago are now playing an absolutely key role in the military confrontation. Groups that are close to terrorist organizations. And that's where this fear comes from many of your friends, that what comes next could be worse than even what you see today. Because here comes the futility of a so-called military victory. This war can end only by two methods. One, military victory, and I hope you saw the quotation marks. Military victory, if it is were to be possible, would lead to exactly what you say, namely the revenge wave that would come. Once you recover, you would hit back. Classic example in history. The other way to end this war is by a negotiated transition. We haven't given Kofi Annan credit enough what he did. He negotiated something on the 30th of June last year, which stated that the negotiations aimed for a negotiated transition. That says a lot, doesn't it? That is what we expect and hope that could happen now. After all, a ceasefire and going into a negotiated transition. Lakhdar Brahimi, who took over after Kofi Annan, is prepared to do that. He's working day and night on this, and we're prepared to start that negotiation any day, as long as when the parties decide and when the major powers of the Security Council decide. But you're right, it is getting more difficult. And that shows again, I hope, the power of this message of prevention. If we act on those first vibrations on the ground and act at that stage, we save so many lives. We save so much money. We save the reputation of our organization, and we save a lot of night sleep. So it's a very, very good question, and I hope I've given you a sufficiently clear answer. Do we have time for two questions or three? Or is that too late now?
I think we have to thank you very much and invite Göran Sölfre once again to listen to your beautiful music.
Let me say in closing that when I heard this wonderful nocturne of Evert Taube, I became horribly homesick. And if you play that one more time, I might shorten my time at the United Nations, but it's beautiful to have Evert Taube and his music come into the room. And I thank you, Göran, for your beautiful music, and thank you for your attention. I became a little bit theoretical in the beginning, but I hope more practical in the end. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Johan Solskjær, for a very nice piece of music. Dear Jan Eliasson, let me, on behalf of the whole audience here, express our warm gratitude and thankfulness for an eloquent, inspiring lecture outlining the challenges pertaining to the prevention and peaceful settlement of disputes. It's extremely interesting for us being outside the inner circle of the United Nations to hear some glimpse of your great knowledge and experience. We certainly agree with you that there is a need to expand the toolbox at hand to give conflict prevention a more prominent role. It's sad that successful efforts, and you have given good examples today, are seldom reported or brought to the knowledge to the general public. Furthermore, conflict prevention is obviously far more cost efficient than trying to stop conflicts when they have burst out. It's indeed an honor and privilege for the Raoul Wallenberg Institute to continue to work together with the United Nations in the spirit of Raoul Wallenberg and of Anna Lindh. As Per Eriksson said, one man or one woman can really make a difference. Dear friends, we have now come to the end of this year's Anna Lindh lecture. Thank you very much.